Welcome back to day 23. I wasn't really satisfied with the half an hour solution from last time, so I found a faster solution. Let's review why the solution was so slow. So we basically took the cup labels and stored them one after the other in an array, right? So for example, if 3 and 8 are neighbors, then they are stored right next to each other in the array. Okay, and this was slow because whenever we looked for an element, let's say 8 is current and we want to find the destination 7, then we have to scan on average half of the numbers in the array. Sometimes we get really unlucky and sometimes we get lucky depending on what we look for. So for part 2, on average, we scanned 500,000 numbers. And then if we wanted to move X, Y, and Z to another place, then again, on average, we had to copy over 500,000 numbers on average. Okay, and that's quite slow, of course. Okay, note that the numbers are unique and contiguous. So we have all the numbers from 1 to 9. No number is missing and no number is twice in there. So we can use a different representation and use the cup labels as indices in an array. And then the values in the array are the successors of those indices. So for example, after 3 comes 8, that's why at index 3 we store an 8. After 8 comes 9, that's why at index 8 we store a 9. After 9 comes 1, that's why we store a 1 at index 9, and so on. And it's a fun exercise to start at 1 and move our way through this array. So for example, 1, 2, 2, 5, 5, 4, 4, 6, 6, 7, 7, 3, 3, 8, 8, 9, 9, 1, and we're back to 1. And we don't use the index 0, so it doesn't really matter what we store here. Okay, so our first exercise is to write this function that converts this input to this output. And the second parameter is just the length of the first parameter for part 1, but for part 2, this will become a much bigger number. But let's ignore that for now. Okay, so how would we start? Maybe let's start by allocating an array for the circle. That would be a long array. And how long does it have to be? So if we have 9 cups, then we need 10, because again, the first one is unused. So that would be inc of total cups. Okay, and then we can use doSeq, which is basically the same as for, but we're not interested in the value, we're only interested in the side effects. Okay, so what I want to do is iterate over the neighboring pairs, right? I want to iterate 3, 8, 8, 9, 9, 1, and so on. And we can do that with our good old friend partition, right? We can partition 2, 1 cups prefix. And in case you forgot what partition does exactly, maybe let's do it for our example input here so you can see it. So this is what partition gives us: the first pair, the second pair, the third pair, and so on. And the last pair would be 6, 7 over here. Okay. So we iterate over all those pairs. And what do we want to do? Well, for example, for 3, 8, we want to store at index 3 the value 8. So we use aset long circle, right? And then I need the first and second element of the pair. So let's immediately destructure that and call it ab. So at index a, we want to store a b. Okay, does that already give us something interesting? Unable to resolve symmetry, so that's because we have to be inside the let, of course. Okay, so does it look like our expected output? Almost, so everything but here. So we haven't stored that after 7 comes 3, because 7, 3 is not a pair in the input, right? That's from here, we want to go back to here. So let's see, that would be an aset long of circle. And for A, we want the last element of input, last cups prefix. And for B, we want the first. Okay, let's see if that gives us the desired result. Yeah, now here we have a 3. Okay, that's looking good. And unfortunately, last is quite inefficient for vectors. So we could be tempted to use peak, for example. That will work for vectors. And it's much faster, as you can see here, for a vector, same as, but much more efficient than last. But for example, for lists or other data structures, it will give you the first element. So I think maybe it's better to stay with last here, just to be on the safe side. It's okay to iterate through 9 elements. Okay, cool. So that already seems to work. So let's go to the next helper function. Similar as last time, we need a destination function that basically finds the first element that is smaller than current, but not the same as x, y, or z. Okay, so let's make a binding that is also called destination, doesn't really matter. And in principle, we want to decrement current. Unless current is 1, then we want to decrement 10 to get to 9, right? So we can say if current is 1, then we want a length of circle, otherwise we want to use current, right? Because the length here is 10 and not 9, so that would give us decrement of length. That looks good. Okay, and then we have to check if we have either of the values x, y, or z. So if x, whoops, if x is equal to destination or y or z, what do we want to do? Then we have to recur. Destination becomes the new current, and of course x, y, and z, whoops, stay the same. Okay. Yeah, otherwise we can simply return, whoops, the destination, right? Then we're done if we found a good element. Let's see if that works. For example, here, the destination for 5 can't be 4 because that's x, so it should be 3. Let's see if that works. Yeah, gives us 3. So I'm somewhat confident that we didn't screw up completely. Okay, and then we can implement the play crab cups function. So here the steps is basically a countdown. So let's first check if we already reached 0. And if so, I return the circle. It doesn't really matter what I return here. I'm not going to use it anyway. I call play crab cups for the side effects and not for the result. Okay. And then I want to bind x, y, z next. Whoops. Next and destination. And maybe a quick ASCII diagram. So we have somewhere we have current x, y, z and next. And then somewhere we have our destination. And let's say after the destination, that also has a successor. Now, what do we have to rebind if we, or relink, if x, y, and z should move? So current gets a new successor, namely n. Z gets a new successor, namely s. And d gets a new successor, namely x. Let's write that down. So c should be linked to n. Z should be linked to s. And d should be linked to x, right? That should make sense. And those are just 3 writes to an array and not 500,000 writes. That should be much more efficient. Okay, so how do we get at x? We can simply look up in the circle for current. That's the whole point of our data structure. We store the successors in the array. Then y is the successor of x, z is the successor of y, and next is the successor of z. And destination, we just wrote our helper function, that would be circle current x, y, z. Okay, and that's why I pass x, y, z to destination instead of looking it up again in there, because we just did it, right? No need to look them up twice. Okay, so those are our let bindings. Now we can write into the array. So we want to aset long circle, and then we want to write 3 times. So the first rebinding from C to N would be current next, right? Then the second rebinding from Z to S would be Z. Well, I didn't store S anywhere, so that would be the successor of destination. And then destination gets a new successor, that would be X. Okay, I think that's, and of course we have to recur, right? Otherwise we'd only do it a single time. So let's recur. The new value of current is next, and steps must be decremented, of course, otherwise we go into an infinite loop. Okay, so how would we use this function now for part 1? Let's see, so we can say we need a circle, cups to circle of personal 9 for my personal input. Okay, and then we want to play the game, so that would be play crab cups circle, current is 1, and we want to perform 100 steps. Okay, and then let's see what the result of that would look like. All right, of course. So let's call seek on it, because arrays don't have a useful to string override. Okay, so what does this tell us? It tells us that after 1, we get 4. Okay, and then 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. After 4, we get 5. After 5, we get 9. After 9, we get 8. After 8, we get 3. 1, 2, 3. After 3, we get 6, and so on, right? Okay, so how could we do that programmatically? We could say, let's start at the successor of 1. That would be the 4 in our case. Okay, and then let's iterate. You already know that. Partial a get circle. So this is basically the same as lambda a get circle percent, right? It binds a circle as the first parameter to a get. Okay, what would that give us? So here you can see 4, 5, 9, 8, 3, 6, 2, 7. That's the answer that we would have to put into the website. And then the whole thing repeats an infinite number of times. So it's sufficient to only take the first 8. Yeah, that's looking good. And then if we are really lazy, we can even call the string join function. And then we get a nice copy-pastable result here. Okay, cool. Oh, that worked. That's quite nice. Okay, then for part 2, we have to revisit our cups to circle function. Here I give you another input. So if instead of 9, I give the function a 13, then the output becomes longer. So the 7 no longer links back to 3. Instead, it links to 10. 10 links to 11, 11 links to 12, 12 to 13. And then finally, the 13 links back to 3. Right? So we have to add those extra elements. Okay, so we can't link back from 7 to 3. What do we have to do instead? We need some kind of loop, of course. So let's write a loop. And let's maybe have an A and a B. And let's think about what's the first A and B that we need if what we want to do is A set long circle AB. Okay, so the first one that we need is the 7 to 10. Okay, so how do we get the 7? That would be the last of cups prefix, right? That's at the very end here. And the 10, how do we get that? That would be the size of cups prefix plus 1, because we need 10 instead of 9. So that would be the increment of count cups prefix. Okay, that should be 7 and 10. Can we somehow check that? So let me comment this out and whoops, and remove this just to make sure that we didn't screw up. 7 and 10, that's looking good. Okay. Okay, cool. Right, and then after storing the 10 at index 7, we need to recur. So, and I don't have an end condition yet. That's also bad. So we need to continue as long as B is smaller than or equal to the total cups, right? Because 13 is the last value that we want to store in the loop. So we have to put this here. Okay. And then we need to recur, but if I just write the recur here, then that would be the else part of the if. So I want to do multiple things, then I need a do. So let's recur and say, so here our B becomes the new value of A. So I write B for A, and our B value increments by 1. So I can say increment B. Okay. Cool. And otherwise, if we reach the end, then we still need to store the 13 to the 3. So that would be a set long circle A. And then the 3 would be the first, right? First of Markups prefix. Okay. Okay, that seems to work. How does it look? Oh, I still pass a 9. Okay, that's looking good. So let's see, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 links to 10. And then here we have 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Yeah, that looks exactly the same as the expected output. That's good. Okay, so we don't need this anymore. Okay, cool. Right, then we can jump down. Maybe start by copying part 1 just for the first couple of lines. So here now, how many do we need? We need 1,000,000 cups. And then we want to play 1,000,000, 10,000,000. Okay, and then the rest is, I don't think, that interesting. Let's see. If we just look at the circle. Yeah, okay, that takes some time. Okay. Right, so that would be the first number that we're interested in, and the successor of that would be the second number we're interested in. Maybe let's time the initialization and the play crab cups. That should be interesting. Okay, and then, yeah, so let's say we need an A and a B. A is A get circle 1, that would be this number, and then B is A get circle of A, right? So the successor of 1. And the successor of 1. Okay, and then we want to multiply. Let's see what that gives us. Okay, so that's definitely the correct result. I remember the 3 ones at the beginning, the 2 eights at the end. And you can see the initialization is trivial, so just about 50 milliseconds, and then the actual game takes about 2 seconds. But we can still optimize somewhat. Let me check something. Yeah, for example, here we didn't provide any type hints, so that will perform some boxings and stuff. So this is longs, then this is a long, this is a long, this is a long, and this is a long. And then we get an interesting compiler error. Functions taking primitives support only 4 or fewer args. Yeah, so here we have primitives, and in total we have 5 arguments, so that doesn't work. Okay, so maybe if we get rid of the last one, then of course the z is unknown, but we can simply get that from the circle again at index y. Then we don't pass the z on. Okay, and then we get recur arg for primitive local. Current is not matching primitive, head number needed long. Yeah, so that's because current is a long, but this guy, which calls a length, which returns an int, which you can't see here, but if you look at the Java implementation, it returns an int. What should be the type of this entire expression? Well, this is int, this is long, the current, or the super type of int and long is number, so this whole thing gets number. So we need to cast this into a long if we really want a long. Here. And then, of course, we don't need to pass the z here, and we don't need to pass the z here. Okay, and now we're under 2 seconds, right? So I think before it was 2700, and now it's 1900. So even with recording, we're now down under 2 seconds. And if I stop the recording, it will be about 1.5 seconds. Okay, really cool. And I was interested how fast would it be in Java. I got it down to 300 milliseconds without JVM warm-up. And with warm-up, I got it down to 160 milliseconds, so about 10 times faster. So I guess the a_get function is probably the bottleneck if you look at the implementation here. That looks non-trivial, whereas in Java, it's just a single bytecode to look up an element and an array. But that's just my intuition. Maybe I'm completely wrong. Let me know if the bottleneck is somewhere else, or the slowdown is somewhere else in Clojure. But that's okay. So if you identify a bottleneck in some number crunching array code, just rewrite it in Java and then call it from Clojure. Calling Java from Clojure is trivial. Okay, cool. So two interesting things from a Clojure perspective, the doSeek function. So what would happen if we replaced this with a for? Then none of those array writes would be executed because we ignore the result of the for. That's a classic mistake, right? So you could use a for and then wrap that in a in a do all, that would also work, but it's much more idiomatic to just use a do seek. So do seek is basically the equivalent to a for loop in other languages, right? It's not the for, it's the do seek. Okay, and then somewhere down here, the partial function is also quite interesting. It's not, I don't see it very often because people just write, well, can't you just write lambda a get circle percent? Yeah, you can do that and it will give you the exact same result. But, you know, if you want to introduce closure to programmers who know a bit of functional programming, then I think partial looks a lot less intimidating. You just say, hey, partial is closure speak for bind. And then most FP programmers should be fine. Okay, cool. So this is my last video on part 23. I'm not going to optimize it further. I'm perfectly fine with 2 seconds. So if you have any suggestions, comments, questions, let me know as always.